Hey, this is Dr. K from iMedicalSchool, and today we're going to give an update on sepsis, talk about its definition, its diagnosis, as well as the management of sepsis. So what is sepsis? Well, sepsis is a very profound inflammatory response to an underlying infection. It leads to significant vasodilation, so your vessels dilate and leading to a drop in blood pressure. Also, because of the inflammatory response, you develop a procoagulant state. So you can develop microemboli that affect perfusion of your organs. Now, when talking about sepsis, we always have to mention SIRS. SIRS is the systemic inflammatory response syndrome. You need two criteria to meet SIRS, and these criteria include temperature less than 96.8, so they're hypothermic, or greater than 100.4, a respiratory rate greater than 20, or a PaCO2 less than 32, a white count less than 4,000, or greater than 12,000. You may also see a bandemia, meaning greater than 10% bands, or immature neutrophils. And finally, a heart rate greater than 90 beats per minute. So your SIRS helps identify an underlying infection and plays a role in the definition of sepsis. So let's talk about our definitions. Start off with sepsis. Well, sepsis, if you meet the SIRS criteria, plus a presumed known source. So SIRS plus a presumed known source, such as the patient's having dysuria or pain with urination, you could think it's a UTI, and if they're meeting the SIRS criteria, you'd call that sepsis. Severe sepsis is a sepsis picture, but they also have organ hypoperfusion. So they could have sepsis and you notice their kidney function is decreased, or they have an elevated creatinine, or they're having trouble breathing. That's severe sepsis. Now, septic shock is sepsis, but now the shock is refractory to fluid. So you're giving tons of fluid boluses, their blood pressure is not coming up, and they meet sepsis criteria. That's septic shock. It's important to know these because you will be pimped on these definitions. Now, the treatment of sepsis. Number one, early recognition. Number two, antibiotics. And number three, fluid resuscitation are really important. And finally, source removal. Whatever is causing the infection, you either want to remove it from the body or treat it. Now, how do we recognize sepsis early? Well, history and physical. That's the answer in every question in medicine. Do a thorough history and physical. When do they get sick? Any known exposures? Do they have any catheters? Anything like that. Look at their vitals. Do they have hypotension? Are they tachycardic? Do they meet SIRS criteria? Get a lactate. So lactate measures your end organ perfusion, as well as central venous oxygenation, SCVO2, are two markers for end organ perfusion and will help you identify a patient who is septic. Finally, there's a new marker called procalcitonin that we're getting now. It is correlated with a significant bacteremia. So if your patient has a bacteremia, your procalcitonin will be high, indicating they have a high probability of developing sepsis. So it's a new marker we're using now in the hospital, something to think about when you're working up your patients who you believe have sepsis. In terms of antibiotics, make sure you get statin antibiotics. Every delay in 1 hour decreases survival by 8%. Two, make sure you have an appropriate antibiotic. Start wide, start broad if you do not know the source, and then narrow based on the culture data. In terms of fluid resuscitation, your real goals in fluid resuscitation within the first 6 hours are one, a CVP from 8 to 12. You know, we usually use crystalloids, but in patients, some patients can use colloids who do not have a lot of albumin on board, but use normal saline or lactated ringers. Two, your MAP greater than 65, and finally your SCVO2 greater than 70%. That's your central venous oxygen saturation. These three factors have been shown to improve survival. To increase your central venous oxygen saturation, one tool you can use by transfusing RBCs to increase your oxygen carrying capacity. Now, vasopressors, if you're unable to achieve adequate tissue perfusion with fluid resuscitation, start pressors. So the Surviving Sepsis campaign recommended that we really start with norepinephrine and work your way up to epinephrine and vasopressin. But really, there is no benefit to one of these over the other. One thing you may want to note is that phenylephrine is preferred if norepinephrine is causing tachyarrhythmias. Now, what do you do? You've been fluid resuscitating greater than 6 hours. You're out of your window. What should you be aware of? Be aware of too much fluid. So they did a study that compared patients who got too much fluids who had sepsis compared to those who just got the right amount of fluids. And fluid overload is linked to poor outcomes. So watch your patient's oxygenation status. Get chest x-rays to make sure they're not developing pulmonary edema. You can even give them some albumin to pull that fluid into their intravascular space. I wouldn't really diurese these patients in the first few couple hours because they are infected. Now, in terms of corticosteroids, well, there's a Corticus trial that showed there's really no benefit in 28-day mortality in terms of giving corticosteroids, but the surviving sepsis campaign showed that those with some baseline adrenal insufficiency responded well to the steroids, but surviving sepsis campaign says if fluids and pressors aren't working, then just give them a stress dose steroids. You do not need to check a ACTH stimulation test to see if they have any type of adrenal insufficiency. So it's kind of your third line go-to drug. In terms of glucoses, as a nice sugar trial said, you want to keep your sugars less than 180. Strict glucose control is actually associated with hypoglycemia and worse outcomes. So now this brings us to Zygris, a activated protein C. Well, it's something we don't use anymore. It was withdrawn from the market. So if it ever comes up, do not use Zygris. It does not improve morbidity and mortality, and it does increase your risk of bleeding. Now, let's say you're trying to treat your patient and they're still persistently sick, they're not getting better. What are other things to think about that you can do? One, always consider changing your antibiotics or add double coverage for Pseudomonas. Think about what other sources could be infected that could be affecting this patient. Do a review of systems. Do they have back pain? Could they have vertebral osteomyelitis that's contributing to their septic picture? Do they have any joint replacements? Are those infected? So really try to keep your broad picture on what's going on and try really to identify the source when your patient is persistently sick and definitely not getting better. Always tailor your antibiotics to your culture data. This will decrease the amount of fluids your patient gets. Also, it'll decrease their exposure to antibiotics. Well, if you like this video, make sure to share your video on both Twitter as well as on Facebook. You can follow us on Twitter at iMedSchool. Give this video a like. If you have any comments or suggestions for any future videos, place them down below. And most importantly, subscribe. We do have a podcast on iTunes called iMedicalSchool, so make sure to check it out. This is Dr. K, and I'll see you next time.